Before Whitesnake, David recorded two solo albums, both of which I was involved with. He contacted me when I was with Snafu, and he was in Purple, but not particularly happy, I don't think, to help him with his first solo album. So we got together. We'd known each other for quite a long time, since the late 60s. So I was, you know, I was very chuffed to get the call. And then worked with him again on his second solo album, North Winds. And from there it evolved into a band. He always wanted to take a band on the road.
You know, he was the guy from Deep Purple, which is a huge band, you know. And, you know, we'd been in 100 bands between us, but we'd not been in bands of the stature of that. I went to see Mickey at the Rainbow. He was playing with Frankie Miller. And I went to see the gig, so I went to see him. And I bumped into David, literally bumped into him in the foyer. And he said, "Oh, what are you doing here?" And I said, "I've come to see Mick." And he said, "No, he didn't." I don't think he even realised that we knew each other. And he had heard the Pal album. The next day they were auditioning people. And David asked me if I'd come down just to listen to these drummers and bass players, basically. And I said, "Yeah, okay, fine." And as I left, he said to me, "Bring a guitar." And that was it. Then we started playing like together, and David was stood in the corner for about 20 minutes listening, wasn't he? And then came over and went like that. So I said, "Oh, hello." That's how it started, really. From then, the three of us then, I think we had a more or less a writing session within a couple of days, didn't we?
Yeah.
Down at some cellar in Newman Street. This is a little bit different to how we originally did it, but the vibe's the same, really, isn't it?
This is how it would have been done in 1934.
Yeah. Okay, this is Trouble. Okay, yeah. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Coming my way.
in the 60s, when we were in our formative years, we should say, obviously we listened to the Stones and the Yardbirds, Spencer Davis Group, the Animals, et al. And we learned who those influences were. And their influences were Chicago blues singers, etc. So we learned from them, really. It's just great for inspiration, even now, to listen to that stuff. Mm. And even though you have your own ideas, you can... There's a certain soul in that kind of music, which is very important, I think, to rock music.
So this song is Till the Day I Die, which is from the Come and Get It album, which is one that seems to be very popular, doesn't it, when we play?
Well, it was at the time, that's for sure.
Yeah, and, well, it was number one, I think.
In
1943.
In Venezuela.
Yeah. It went wood.
It went wood. Double wood, and they paid us in goats.
Yeah. But it goes like this. This is Till the Day I Die. One, two, three, four. Cold winds of winter chill me to the bone. Thoughts of summer breezes turn my heart to stone. When I need you there to guide me, it's more than I can bear. A shoulder I can cry on. Bring me love when you're not there. So bring me love. Bring me love. Bring me love. Till the day I die. Till the day I die. Slowly I awaken to the weaver's plan for me. Drift upon the ocean of my own uncertainty. To look for a companion to keep me company. A guiding hand to understand and walk the road with me. So bring me love. Bring me love. Bring me love. Till the day I die. Bring me love. Bring me love. Bring me love till the day I die, till the day I die, till the day I die. I've never been a river off my destiny. Yeah. When everything I have is yours, and all I have to do. Bring me love, bring me love, bring me love, till the day I die. Bring me love, bring me love, bring me love, till the day I die, till the day I die.
till the day I die. Oh yeah.
M3 is all about playing the classic Whitesnake stuff. And, you know, we had a thing before called The Company of Snakes, which was a good band. It was a really good band. We made a very decent studio album. But when we would play that stuff live, it would be politely received. And then we would do something in Whitesnake and it would be uproariously received. So we realized, you know, we were just taking one step forward and two back. And people really wanted to hear the classic Whitesnake stuff. So that's why M3 began.
But I knew it wasn't right. But I paint all the colors when it really should be black and white. Sail my ship through muddy waters, try to open every door. When I saw the seven wonders, it left me unable. I'm a child. I know how it will be. I'm prepared to meet my maker with no hope for charity. I'll stand alone and pay the price for everything I've done. 'Cause there ain't a God. Child of Babylon.
The twin guitar thing was always was something we both liked. I always loved the Allman Brothers band. It was my favourite band, and I think Bernie was into the Allman Brothers too, and Lynyrd Skynyrd. You know, that was the kind of thing I was into more so than heavy rock, really. And that's the thing we kind of developed between us, though we didn't copy those particular bands. I think we put our own stamp on it.
Mm.
Trouble itself, the first album, in retrospect now, is direction nil, enthusiasm 11. You know, Day Trippers on there by the Beatles. And yet, you know, we had the temerity to go out and say, no, we'll do it like this. And it is really good. It's a great version. But it all works.
We did what we wanted to do. We did, really. Yeah. We didn't really.
And in those days as well, it was, you know, the record company didn't have... they didn't have any control, really. I mean, once they signed you, you know, the album they got was the album that we recorded. I know it's different these days, and whether that's good for, you know, development or not, I don't know whether a lot of us would have survived the regimes that run the record industry these days, because we were given, and for that I think we are grateful, because you made an album, and when they got the album was when you finished it.
If we run something like, say, Love Hunter... This is how they started, really, isn't it?
Yeah, the acoustic thing. You always tended to write an acoustic guitar. Yeah. I don't know why, but...
Using somebody's flat in the morning. Yeah.
But, I mean, how did they start? Well, I think something like Love Hunter, I think I probably came up with the original feel, which was kind of based on a Bert Jansch picking thing. It was a Bert Jansch tune. Which became.
Well, you had. I remember you had that whole figure sorted out anyway before.
Well, I think the only
we've done in a rehearsal.
The only lyrical content I ever contributed to White Snake's probably "I'm a Love Hunter Baby Creeping Up on You," which was kept. And
you was a writer.
Yeah, I think I put the Led Zeppelin bit in the night.
A little bit.
Yeah.
When you come back from the pub.
Yeah.
But yeah, so I started on like a picking thing.
Yeah. Need a woman, treat me good. Give me everything. Good woman should, every day and every night, waiting on a bright eye girl, love and train her right. I'm a love hunter, baby, picking up on you. I'm a love hunter, baby, sneaking up on you. Time I've been a beggar man, giving everything I want, doing the best I can. Don't want no woman weep or moan. Never gonna leave her alone. I'm a love hunter, baby.
up on you. Should I left it like that?
Yeah.
Doing this stuff like this is always interesting because, A, like, in, you know, in that case, you know, I forget the phrasing. But when you're playing and singing together, I'm not used to doing those songs, and you realise how good what he did was on it and stuff. And because it all came together so well, you just took it for granted. You break it down nowadays. There's stuff on the Whitesnake albums that guitar-wise, that we have no recollection of doing. Which is, don't know whether it's to be proud of or to admit, I don't, but it's true. There's guitar parts on there that, you know, we'll listen to stuff and...
It's purely inspired stuff, you know, off the cuff.
There's stuff. Harmony guitar parts underlaid in the tracks and we have no idea when they did them. See, there it goes, third person, it's like ridiculous.
In between having a good time, we'd slip in the studio and...
Make an album.
Put a few things down. Mm. Time is right for love, remember that.
I love this one.
So do I.
Oh, okay. We never play this one live, so... Do we ever play this live?
Originally?
Yeah.
Once, I think.
Once, Hammersmithonian.
And that was it. I don't know why we didn't do it again, but... probably considered a bit too commercial for our rebellious stance.
So this is The Time Is Right for Love.
Thank you.
can pray to the Lord above that the time is right for love. Well, the time is right for love. Time is right for love. You can pray to the Lord above that the time is right for love. Time is right.
I did a solo album about 25 years ago, whatever it was, and I put on it, this is dedicated to musicians who are told to get a proper job. Just said, don't.